Zhu, who's at UC Irvine and actually in Berkeley this semester. Yizhe.
I'm very happy to be here. Currently, I'm working at MSRI, so it's very convenient to come down to Simon's. Today, I will talk about a joint work with Zhichao Wang, a PhD student from UCSD, about the spectrum of nonlinear random matrices for ultra-wide neural networks. So we're interested in this fully connected two-layer neural network model, where we have a parameter theta and a function f that take a vector x to a value f theta x given by the two-layer network, where x is a data set with dimension n by d. So every vector is of dimension d, and we have n vectors. And w is the weight matrix that keep track of the weight on every edge. And after you pass the first layer, you get another matrix y, which is the output of the first hidden layer. And the training parameters are given by theta, which is the weight matrix w and the output layer little w. At initialization, we will take every random variable theta from IID standard Gaussian. And here the activation function sigma is the Lipschitz function applied entry-wise to the matrix W times X. So actually I want to call this Y to be X1 for the output of the first layer. So we're interested in two types of kernel matrices in this setting. The first one is called the conjugate kernel. We denoted by KCK, which is the Y x1 transpose times x1. So x1 is the output of the first layer. And this matrix governs the property of a random feature regression, or you also the property of random neural network with only the output layer was trained. And also recently, its limiting spectral distribution got a lot of interest in random matrix theory in the regime where all the parameters are proportional. So the width of the network divided by the dimension converts to a constant. Also, the dimension of the vector divided by the sample size converts to another constant. In this case, if you calculate the limiting spectral distribution, it behaves like a Marchenko-Pascal law, but it's, there's some deformation coming from the derivative of the activation function. Another matrix we could analyze is this neural tangent kernel matrix, where you take the gradient with respect to all the parameters theta, and you form a sample covariance type matrix. And now this NTK matrix has two components. The first component is a canonical product of the data matrix and all the parameter from the first layer and output layer, plus another part that's coming from the conjugate kernel. So the training error evolved during the gradient descent can be analyzed by using this neural tangent kernel in the large width limit. And if we fix little n and take large n goes to infinity, such matrix converge its expectation, and it will be fixed during the training for large width limit. So there have been a lot of research on this optimization side for to analyze this random matrix. And today our question is, what are the spectral behavior of this conjugate kernel and neural tangent kernel matrix in a new parameter regime where the width of the neural network goes to infinity, but it is faster than the training sample size. So in this case, you don't expect to have a Marchenko-Pascal law behavior because the parameter does not converge to a constant. And so we call this regime ultra-wide neural network. So what is known in this regime? There's a classical result by Bai and Yin for sample covariance matrix when the dimension are unproportional. So let's take a D by N random matrix with IID entry. If you have finite fourth moment and variance one, then you have to center the sample covariance by identity matrix and multiply by an extra factor D over N. If you take D and N goes to infinity, but D is much faster than N, this will converge to the semicircular law. So this picture shows you the limiting spectrum distribution if you increase the ratio of D over N. So at the beginning, it looks like Bayesian Poisson law, but after the shift and rescaling, you can keep it in the same support, but you see the shape of the Bayesian Poisson law gets more and more symmetric. And at the end, it converts to semicircular law. So we want to analyze if this similar behavior could appear in this neural network setting. So now we look at this conjugate kernel matrix, which is the sigma of WX transpose times another sigma WX. So now we need to make some assumption about the data matrix. Here we assume the data matrix are deterministic, but they satisfy a approximate pairwise orthogonal assumption. So the vectors are nearly of length one, and they are pairwise nearly orthogonal, where we have a parameter sigma n that goes to zero with a certain rate. And we allow the total difference between the length of every vector, between the length and one, to be bounded by b squared, and the operator norm is bounded by b. Another assumption is we assume the limiting spectral distribution of x transpose x converges to a deterministic distribution as n goes to infinity. So for those kind of data matrix, you can generate a random matrix and conditioning on the property holds. So we can cover not only the Gaussian random vector, but you can have some random vector with dependent entries, but satisfy some concentration property. And this property would hold. And also here we have these random vectors in dimension D. To make such nearly orthogonal property holds, we also need to make D grow with N, otherwise this would fail. And the assumption on the activation function is that we do a normalization. So if D is proportional to N, this would hold. Because I only need N times epsilon N to the fourth goes to zero. Yes. So we need assumption on the activation function with three parameters. So when you take a Gaussian random variable and act the sigma function on the random variable, it is centered. And the sigma square of Ksi under the expectation is one. And there's another parameter that tells you the expectation of sigma prime under the Gaussian random variable. So we can always have a Lipschitz function of sigma, but with the centering and the normalization to make such property hold. Okay, so what is the result we get? Under those assumptions, if you calculate the conjugate kernel K minus its expectation, and we rescale it by square root big N over N, this will converge to a free convolution of semicircular law multiplied by another distribution that depends on the initial data matrix mu zero and the parameter B sigma that comes from the first derivative of the activation function. And under the regime that all the parameter goes to infinity, but big N over little n goes to infinity as well. And you can prove the same limiting behavior for the neural tangent kernel matrix. So here I plot a picture when you have this derivative term B sigma being zero. And now in this expression, if B sigma is zero, this term becomes one and it's independent of the distribution of the data matrix. So you get semicircular law. So how do I make this sigma, B sigma being zero? You can take a cosine function and do a center and normalization to make the condition hold. Okay. Here's our other simulations. If we change the activation function, the limit shape will change in different ways, but the dependence is only on the first derivative of the activation function. Mm-hmm. Oh.
The neurotending kernel had two terms.
Yes. Yeah, so you can do some concentration analysis to show that the first term fluctuates at a smaller order. So when we take the limiting spectral distribution, we can take that term to vanish. So it, at the end, they will have the same limiting spectral distribution.
Is that something to do with your normalization conditions? Don't normalize, you won't have that term.
Oh, yeah, the normalization here is important because if you don't normalize, then the difference of those two matrices will convert to zero.
You also have the sigma
normalization. The sigma normalization condition, it's normalized by a constant because I need to have the three quantity there. So you can always do a center and the normalization, but it's independent of the parameter. Another question for the statement?
For the next part, I didn't get what are the differences from this quantity.
Oh, so I take a different activation function sigma here. And after the centering and normalization, I plot a different picture. The red curve is the theoretical prediction you can compute from the free convolution of the two limiting spectral distribution, and the data are generated by Gaussian random variables.
You cannot cover radu.
X plus this is radu. Yeah. Okay. In the ingredient of the proof, we use two facts about the Gaussian random vector. First of all, we prove a nonlinear Hansen-Wright inequality that's suitable for this analysis. We take a Y, which is a the random vector W multiplied by the data matrix act on the sigma function, where W is Gaussian. And we can use the concentration property of the Gaussian random variable and use some other result for Hansen-Wright inequality with dependent random vector with dependent entries. Then you can get a Hansen-Wright inequality in this case. That's very helpful to do the analysis of the resolvent. And this improves some dependence of the parameter in the paper by Luard et al. In 18. And another part we use the Gaussian assumption is that to get a nice expression about the free convolution, this term is very clean. The reason is that you can do this approximation about the covariance matrix by using Ermi polynomial expansion. And now and you can approximate this expectation by another deterministic matrix phi zero that incorporate this derivative and the limit the distribution of the data matrix plus some low norm terms. So by using that, we simplify the result for the free convolution part, make it only depend on the derivative term. Besides the limiting structural distribution, you can also characterize the where is the largest eigenvalue. So by using some epsilon net argument, we can prove that the spectral norm of the conjugate kernel matrix minus expectation is concentrated on the compact set. So the order of the difference is at the order square root lead O n over big O n. So as long as big O n goes over little O n goes to infinity, they are concentrated. So this gives you a upper bound on the largest eigenvalue, but the limiting spectral distribution gives you a lower bound on the largest eigenvalue. So if you combine the two results, it tells you the operator norm of this difference. Conjugate kernel matrix and its expectation is exactly of order little n over big O n. And you can prove similar bound for the neural tangent kernel matrix. Yeah. But if you do matrix concentration, you will get the log n factor. Okay. Yeah, so if we do matrix Bernstein inequality, it will be square root little or big N, but up to a log factor. Yes. So using this concentration result, we can analyze a simplified model for random feature regression. If you train the label with a linear function y, that's given by the data x transpose times a random coefficient beta star plus a epsilon a noise term, and we assume the new data x is independent of the testing data set capital X, such that if you put the new data vector into this X matrix, it's again a epsilon n b orthogonal matrix. So every columns are nearly orthogonal, and the operator norm is bounded by b. If you assume also the covariance is identity over d, then we can calculate the test error. In this case, it turns out that if we are at this regime that capital N over little n goes to infinity, then the test error for random feature ridge regression minus the test error for this kernel ridge regression given by the expectation matrix, the error goes to zero at a rate that's given by the capital N over little n. But this is only a very particular model that we managed to analyze using the concentration result. There are more general results of this type in the paper by May et al. This year. Okay. Yeah, I think I'll stop here and thank you for your attention.
One quick question.
Have there any result or recommendations where you don't have to be there for the second term? And if it's not full, is it not a problem?
So now there are several results in this proportional regime. In Pennington and Lowrat, all the four paper, their result only depend on the first derivative. But if the orthogonal property gets worse, you need to see second derivative or third derivative into the limiting spectrum. I haven't seen any people on that.
Yeah, in our papers on random feature.
So is the limiting spectrum calculated? Okay, let's see.
Right, thanks.